Our Lady, Mother of the Church, Saint Joseph, our patron saints and guardian angels, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. In the first reading, we hear the prophecy of concerning David and his wanting to build a house, a proper dwelling place for the Ark of the Covenant, because he was dwelling in a palace and the ark was in a tent. And we find that through the prophet Nathan that David will not build this house but his son, but that this house will truly be a house in which God will establish his kingdom forever, and that his that the God says that I will be a father to him and he shall be a son to me. And how true and how literally true does God make that prophecy come true when the incarnation takes place? That he truly did establish a house for his son. The most beautiful dwelling place that he gave to his son to dwell in was the womb of the Virgin Mary. As we know, Saint Francis prayed in that famous prayer that he composed to Our Lady, she's the Virgin Made Church. She's the Virgin Made the House of God. And truly God has given a dwelling place for his son. And all of us, when he placed his son in Our Lady's womb, in a spiritual way, each and every one of us was placed there in the womb of Our Lady to be nourished by her, as the church sometimes refers to, and in the ancient times referred to, the baptismal font, the womb of the church. Our Lady brings us into the church through the baptismal font, where she grants us the grace as the mediatrix of all graces. She brings us into the church, into the womb of the church. And there we are able to be nourished by her with the graces given to us by her son. And this dwelling place is in many ways, the church has those same qualities that Our Lady has. You know, it's truly a maternal place, the church. Our mother, as we refer to the church as Holy Mother Church, truly is a reflection of that maternal kindness and tenderness of Our Lady. And that is one thing that stands out among all religions, one thing that the Catholic religion has that you won't find in Buddhism, Mohammedism especially, or any other Hinduism. You will not find this maternal tenderness that is so well expressed in our hymns, in our prayers, in the way that the church conducts even its liturgy. It is always in a very way, it's a very subtle but tender and maternal way in which the church deals with its children. And this is nothing more than a reflection of that first church that our Lord dwelled in, but Our Lady's most immaculate womb. And then in the gospel today, we see Zechariah finally having his lips loosed, and he's able to speak after finally he gives the name, the official name of this son that is born to him and Saint Elizabeth. His lips are finally opened, and he's able to prophesy the great Benedictus, this hymn that is enshrined in the divine office in morning prayer, and in opposition or alongside the Magnificat of Our Lady, which we pray in the Vespers. These two great hymns composed by individuals who are inspired by the Holy Spirit. And Zechariah, we can see truly here that when he proclaimed these praises, we must not forget that Our Lady and Our Lord were present there. You know, Our Lady stayed for 3 months with her cousin Elizabeth. And I don't think Our Lady would depart just before the birth since she was there to help her elderly cousin, that she was truly standing there beside or in the presence of Zechariah and Elizabeth and all those who came there for this great event to name this child. And we must not also forget that our Lord is there in Our Lady's womb. So here he is in the presence of Our Lady and the infant, the tiny little Savior in her womb, and he prophesies this great hymn of confidence and in praising God and his great mysteries. You know, he had 9 months to be silent and to reflect on his disobedience or his lack of faith in what the angel Gabriel told him. And finally, when his lips are free to speak, he speaks so clearly, you might say that he learned his lesson well in that penance that he was given of not being able to speak. And God finally was able to fill his mind and his heart with great love and confidence and faith in God's fidelity to his promises. All the promises that God had made to the people of Israel of sending them a Savior was finally accomplished. And with John, his son, being the precursor of this great Savior, Zechariah just cannot state the praises of God's fidelity to those promises that he made to his people, how he has raised up a Savior, born of the house of the servant David, who he had been telling them from so many ages before that he would finally do that. And it was fitting. You know, God didn't just randomly throw dice and say, okay, now it's going to be... Everything was planned according to God's purposeful will. And he chose the proper time and place. And it was done in the most beautiful manner. And so Zechariah, in seeing how God and his mysterious ways are unfolded in his life, praises God that even though he suffered the being cast mute, he sees even in that, you know, God's loving kindness towards him. And I think that maybe we can learn from Zechariah in our own lives as we approach this soon-to-be Christmas season, that in our lives we have many trials, we have many difficulties. We may even sometimes fail in our fidelity to God, or we may be slow to believe. But if we are truly repentant and we are truly always wanting to have a generous heart and a certain goodwill, then God will even use these setbacks or these lack of fidelity or these times when we fail maybe to believe in the first instance. God will even take those moments and use them for a greater good. And we must not lose sight of that. Even the tragedies that occur, you know, in the recent events in our country, if we learn from them, if we turn to God and we listen to what he is speaking to us in when we go to pray and when we have an interior life and we try and do everything we can to please God, even though sometimes we may falter, we must be able to see that even in the tragedies that God can bring good from them if we are faithful and if we make use of the means of his grace. And that's the thing that many times those who are disheartened and lose faith when some tragedy comes is because they do not have this wisdom, you might say, that comes from on high to see beyond the the event or the tragedy to see that all things are part of God's counsels and He can work through them all. We can see that in our own Lord's life Himself, that when He came down from heaven in the womb of the Virgin Mary, many things happened. Many terrible things happened. He was persecuted. He was pursued by His enemies, even as an infant. And yet all these things worked for the greater glory of God. And that's the thing that, even in His Benedictus, that Zechariah blesses God for these great mysteries, that God has fulfilled His promises and is not going to be thwarted as long as we remain faithful, and if we should falter, that we repent and rise again, but always know that our solution is our Savior, lies in Jesus. And if we always look to Him, He will always be there to help and save us and to enlighten us and to show us the way as He comes as the light of the world this evening in Christmas season. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.